I am.
Our pseudo live.
Okay. Let's call the Village Board of Zoning Appeals meeting for Wednesday, January 27th. And let's call it to order. Can we call the roll, please?
Pallotta.
Here.
Zopf.
Yes.
Samuelson.
Yes.
Reed.
Here.
All right, we have a quorum.
Excellent. A review of the agenda tonight. Looks like we just have one hearing for Gavin regarding ADU. Are there any communications tonight?
There were none.
Okay. Shall we review the minutes from our November 18th meeting?
I have reviewed them and I move that we adopt.
Tony Salmons in seconds.
Perfect. Should we call the roll on that or we're good to go?
I can do a voice vote, but
we're good to go.
Judy would normally do a roll call. So Pallotta.
Yes.
Zopf.
Yes.
Samuelson.
Yes.
Reed.
Stain.
Good. Well, we're moving on. Judy, I'm sorry.
Denise.
Denise, you want to go over what this public hearing that we're going over with Gavin, please?
Could I bring up a point first? Mm-hmm. When I read through this thing that Judy passed out, it says the structure is already grandfathered. Is there a reason for this meeting?
Yes.
Yeah.
Because this, what he's now going to do is an accessory dwelling unit within this structure, and our code requires our code requirements for an accessory dwelling is 800 square feet maximum. So, because this is a existing structure, they're asking for a variance to that.
The way. Whoever wrote the notes out says this is an existing grandfathered structure. So if it's grandfathered, what are we approving?
Your change in use.
If it was just if it was just staying as an accessory structure, then that we wouldn't even be here. But because they're wanting to change the use to an accessory dwelling unit. And the code says 800 square feet maximum. They're asking for a variance because they want to use more than 800 square feet.
Okay.
Denise, okay. Just while we're sort of on the subject, mm-hmm. I noticed that there was an addition put onto that accessory structure in 1991 mm-hmm. that moved it from being compliant with the current code to not compliant. In 1991, was the code different and allowed larger accessory structures, or was that done illegally?
I did not look at that. I just looked at based on our current code, so I don't know.
That was a previous owner, not this owner, so
correct.
Make that clear. But it wasn't all, the building that goes back to 1900 is in compliance. There was an addition put on it in 1991 of an extra 400 square feet that took it out of today's compliance.
Okay.
So should we go ahead, Denise, and read through the request?
Sure. So pretty much we kind of covered it. The structure, the footprint currently, according to Greene County Auditor, is 950 square feet. The architect, Ted Donnell, who's online here, said that's not an accurate measurement, and he measured the main level at 937 square feet, plus that porch area, which measures 190 for a total of 1,127 square feet footprint. They're not using all of that. They're gonna keep a couple areas that for storage. They have entrances, their own entrance on the side of the barn. And then we don't count the three season room because it's not an actual living area. So what the calculation comes out to was 951 square feet would be the actual accessory dwelling unit. It's an up and downstairs plan. So the variance that they're requesting is a variance of 151 square feet. And both the applicant and the architect are here.
Yeah, Denise, that discrepancy between the county and the architect may have to do with the county measures the outside of the building and our regulations for habitable space measure the interior of the building, which is can be a significant difference.
Yeah, I would imagine it would be more significant than what we're showing here. So I don't know. But it hasn't been remodeled yet. So we're not actually measuring the interior with the actual walls put in.
I have a question, which is, I understand that in terms of the, you know, the impact, the structure is, footprint is not changing other than you mentioned an awning.
An awning, yeah.
But it's hard to know. I mean, since our rules for accessory structures and secondary dwellings are now the same, it probably, in a sense, doesn't make any difference. But there is the option, as we've learned with this analysis, that you don't have to use the whole accessory structure. You don't have to convert the whole accessory structure into a habitation. So if right. you only converted 800 square feet of it, right. it would be fine. And for example, I look and say, oh, there's the new awning, which if you're counting that as a changing the footprint, that entryway could be recessed rather and have, you know, be sheltered without making a major compromise of the design, and that would reduce a little bit more the actual area that's being converted to a dwelling.
Yeah, I actually wasn't counting
that kind of change.
I'm sorry, I wasn't counting the awning because that's not living area. So,
well, I just. Yeah. I know from our zoning and setbacks, things like that do make a difference. But it doesn't count as living area, so it's irrelevant.
It's, yeah.
It just called my attention to the fact that that would be a simple change that would reduce the living space, the 800, you know, get us closer to 800 square feet without making a major compromise to the current design.
I think really, honestly, if they said it was 800 square feet and then they hadn't actually remodeled it yet, and then they remodeled it and went in and remeasured, it would probably be less, quite a lot less than 800 square feet. And I would guess that once they actually do the interior remodel of this and they go in and remeasure, it'll probably be quite reduced, wouldn't you think, from the 951 down to 800 if they measure from the interior.
It depends how that 951 was measured, whether it was from exterior walls or interior, how thick the new walls are going to be.
Exactly. And then the upstairs has this, it's kind of sloped, so they're not able to use that whole floor area.
Presumably the numbers we have reflect that. Don't the numbers we have for the second floor reflect the area that has at least 7 feet of
as much as they could, and they might want to speak to that.
Sure. Why don't we let Ted break in here and he give us what the details are, what's happening.
I can briefly summarize that. We were commissioned to do a study on the viability of getting acceptance of this existing building as an ADU. We were not commissioned to do any architectural work past just getting the due diligence phase done. And the economics of that makes sense. You know, the client would not want to pay us to continue to do work without knowing if he can move forward. So we have to make some assumptions going into this, and you know, because that's just the way it is. We can't spend our clients' money to just make things up and then change them once we get a commission to do the work.
So we have Gavin online too, right?
Yes.
We could probably ask the question of Gavin what the intent is and where we're going with this, right?
Yeah, sorry. Can you restate what my internet's just a little choppy. Can you just restate what is the question or the intent that I'm answering?
I guess we're looking for what is your intent of the building? How much were you looking to use? What is your goal on this auxiliary dwelling unit?
Sure. So the goal, as we talked about with, for those of you that, I guess maybe nobody is other than Denise and Raven, maybe you weren't part of the planning commission. So anyway, yeah, the goal of it is to provide, to have a space. We're thinking we'll use it, like about half of the year for sort of personal, like sort of family use, and then half of the year as a accessory dwelling unit, you know, for the purposes of, Airbnb or some sort of short-term rental. So yeah, that's the basic idea. And yeah, so then once we were looking at figuring out how to, you know, look at the space, it just seemed like it made natural sense to sort of use the current footprint. The only change was that awning, which I don't think an awning, you know, makes much of a change in the, you know, sort of functional space or whatever. So we were just trying to figure out how would the space flow and how would we have a good, you know, good footprint. So that was all. I don't know, Alex or Ted, you could say something different, but we were just trying to figure out how to use the space appropriately within that, you know, toward that end. Is that answering your question?
I think what you're saying is you wanted to use as much of the space as you could, as opposed to you wanted to remodel it to 800 square feet.
Yeah, I mean, I would say if we were trying to remodel it to do as much as we could, then we would also be asking to turn the three season room into a full, you know, into a full year round, you know, part of the structure. We would not have any storage in the building. So so I wouldn't say we were like trying exactly to, I would say it's in between. We weren't trying to figure out how to get to 800. And in fact, in talking to Ted and Alex, I felt like, hey, and we tried some configurations that were at 800 square feet, and it felt like it was like forcing something in, like the space wasn't designed in that way. And so I sort of felt like, well, if it's a small change and it's not changing the footprint at all, I just assume have the space flow well and work toward our ends. So I guess I'd say it was in between 800, you know, we weren't trying to make it exactly 800, and we also were not trying to use all of the space for dwelling purposes.
Let me ask one more question, and maybe this is more to Denise. Can you give us on the Board of Zoning Appeals any counsel on what's a small change? I mean, you said, you know, this change is about 20%. Is that a small change, a medium change?
The zoning code, as I recall, there is something, and Brianne, maybe you might have seen it, where at least when you're talking about, well, that's more setbacks, it would have to be something less than half. So this would be about 20%.
Well, this is far less than half. Okay, if 50% is, if under 50% is a small change, then we're not,
well,
not a major request.
Yeah, I would ask Brianne if she has any sense of that.
It's going to be by your Duncan factors. I mean, that's for any BZA request on a variance you're looking at, you know, in terms of Richard's question to whether it's a small change, a large change, a substantial change versus, the zoning code is set at 800 square feet for the ADUs. Obviously a lot of thought and discussion went into the process when the zoning code was adopted to get that number, but it is something that is like any zoning code, unique to the village itself. So in the grand scheme of things, is 151 square foot variance, like Denise said, being less than 20%, that's really something that the BZA is going to have to decide whether that's something, when you take into account the Duncan factors, that it's something that's acceptable to the BZA in terms of being a bridge too far or something that's within the parameters and a reasonable request.
And so we're clear too, the footprint's not changing. We're right. just remodeling. We're not doing anything extending the building. And Planning Commission's already looked through this. So we're pretty much on good grounds. We're just looking at this 151 foot square foot variance mm-hmm. within the building, within the structure.
I think if I can add a little perspective to that, if when we looked at this and interpreted what substantial change was, we had an existing building footprint. And to get to 800 square feet versus what we are submitting for would not be any difference from the perspective of the outside view, the footprint of the building, the outside shape or character of the structure. So any changes to get down to 800 square foot would be internal and irrelevant from a zoning point of view when it comes to site and distance and coverage and all of those other elements that are important to the character of the neighborhood.
Well, all right, I would make an exception to that in so much as the larger the unit is, the in terms of it being a residence, the more potential impact it has. The more people can live in it, the more activity can take place. You know, this is, we're not, for example, we're adding a second house here, but we're not adding more parking or, you know, some of the other things that go along. I don't know whether the 800 square feet was determined based on I think it was based on it, the second building being subservient or, you know, significantly smaller than the house. And that's, matter of fact, you know, you look, it's either a percentage of the house or 800 square feet, whichever is the critical number. And so there is a reason to limit that size that has to do with the use of the building, not just how much space the building takes up.
And so the Planning Commission did look at that and you know, it meets the criteria in all other aspects. It's only one bedroom. It has a living area, a bathroom, a kitchen area, and a laundry room. And there is like ample parking. It's a pretty big lot, actually.
Well, I understand.
So I want to bring up a couple other things on this. Gavin's got an Airbnb. Not a problem. We've already talked about that before in Planning Commission. Parking wasn't an issue. Residents, Gavin, no one complained about or questioned about the Airbnb. There's been, obviously, we haven't received any communication, so there's nobody that's uptight about the ADU, correct?
Yeah, there was actually a couple, and Raven, there were like two letters in support. They weren't abutting neighbors, but they were neighbors.
Yeah, two local residents of the village sent letters that were included in the Planning Commission packet.
Yeah.
So having said that, then lastly, there was a business back there at some time prior to, I don't know if it was prior to Gavin, but there was a business back there, correct? Of some sorts?
I don't know. I'm sorry.
I ran like a summer camp, like pottery classes thing.
Right. For years. That's what I thought.
We have nothing since I've been here.
So basically what I'm getting at is that all this is lining up that we're pretty good. We're going in the right direction here. I would feel that we don't have any complaints from the residents around. There's already been existing. There's an Airbnb. We've got these things going on that are all lined up already. And this is not, as even what Richard said, doesn't look to be a substantial improvement as far as enhancing the area.
There was actually only one concern raised by a neighbor at the November 18th meeting. A neighbor was concerned about parking on street because they had a rental property with no off-street parking available. That's the only concern we've heard.
Which I'll just say is like totally fine. And we're going to provide parking. We've already gone through that in the ADU, but also it's an interesting dynamic, right? Is that the place across the street that has four rental places with no off-street parking is worried about parking. Like if anybody should have to have parking, it'd be them.
Do you have any other questions or can we move to Duncan's?
I have one. I'm still confused from my opening statement. So what we're waiving is he needs to exceed the living space by 191 feet because the zoning reg says you can't have an APU greater than 860%, whatever it is, or 800 feet. That's what we're waiving.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, I didn't know. Okay.
So, procedural here, we have to have a public hearing to at what point? Is that before Duncan Factors?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay.
So we'll open it up for public hearing. Anyone?
No one contacted me for the link, so I don't believe we'll have any.
We will then close the public hearing. And we're very slow. Anything from us, from the rest of us here? If nothing more, then I guess we should proceed on to Duncan's then. Yes?
Yes.
Who's going to read the questions for Duncan's?
I can.
Okay.
Give me a second here. Bring them up. All right. We'll start with Duncan Factor 1, whether the property in question will yield a reasonable return or whether there can be any beneficial use of the property without the variance. Call the roll on that. Pallotta?
Yes.
Stop.
Yeah, I can never tell what yes or no means on this one. The property can have a reasonable return without the variance.
I think that's a yes then.
That sounds like a yes.
I'll put that down as a yes. Salmonson.
Yes.
Reed.
Yes.
Okay. Next up, we have whether the variance is substantial. Again, that's substantial is a what you make of it. It's a legal term of art, and it's not expressly defined in our code. So it's a matter of opinion.
Okay.
Pallotta.
No.
Zolf.
No.
Salmonson.
No.
Reed.
No.
Whether the essential character of the neighborhood would be substantially altered or whether adjoining properties would suffer a substantial detriment as a result of granting the variance. Pallotta.
No.
Zopf.
No.
Salmonson.
No.
Reed.
No.
Okay. Whether the variance... I don't know. Denise, did you put in your report whether factor four was actually something that was not applicable?
One.
Government services.
This was the delivery of government services.
Existing.
Yeah, I mean, it's not applicable because it's already existing.
It's already existing.
I will not take a vote on that one. Number five, whether the property owner purchased the property with knowledge of the zoning restriction. Pallotta.
No.
Zopf.
I believe the property owner had knowledge of the restrictions or he wouldn't have hired an architect to work on it.
Salmonson.
No.
Reed.
I mean, we could ask him, but say.
I zoned out. What would I be asked?
Whether you purchased the property with knowledge of the zoning restriction.
No, I mean, no. I mean, when I bought the house, I wasn't thinking about this. We've been here 5 years. We started thinking about it. I mean, I knew about it eventually, but not certainly not when we bought the house.
I'll give it a no.
Okay. Factor six, whether the property owner's predicament feasibly can be obviated through some method other than a variance. Pallotta.
No.
Zopf.
Yes.
Samuelson.
Yes.
Reed.
Yes.
Whether the property owner's predicament, whether the existing conditions from which a variance is being sought were self-created. Pallotta.
Yes.
Zopf.
Yes.
Samuelson.
Yes.
Reed.
Yes.
And finally, whether the spirit and intent behind the zoning requirement would be observed and substantial justice done by granting the variance. Pallotta.
Yes.
Zopf.
Okay.
Samuelson.
Yes.
Reed.
Yes.
Okay. So you have voted on the Duncan factors individually. And again, for the Duncan factors, as the village's solicitor, I would reiterate that those are balancing factors that the BZA has to consider when deciding whether or not to grant the variance in and of itself. So I don't know if the chair wants to call for a vote on the approval of the variance or the disapproval of the variance based on the consideration of the Duncan factors.
Okay, I'd like to put forward a motion to approve the variance of 151 square feet for the ADU. May I get a second?
I'll second that.
I'm sorry, who seconded?
Reed.
Are we gonna discuss this?
Now that there's a second, absolutely.
Okay, I'd like to change the wording to not more than 151 feet. You say 151 feet, it might not be 151 feet. I just say not more than would be my suggestion or recommendation.
Is that a motion to amend, Tony?
It's a motion to amend, if that's, I can do that.
I'll second that motion.
Okay. So I'll take a vote on the motion to amend the underlying motion. Pallotta.
Yes.
Zopf.
Yeah.
Samuelson.
Yes.
Reed.
Yes. Okay.
And then to approve as amended, roll call vote. Pallotta.
Yes.
Zopf.
Yeah.
Samuelson?
Yes.
Reed?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Yay.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you. Nice to see you, Ted. Congratulations.
Good to see you all.
Thank you. Appreciate your time.
Denise, is there any agenda planning coming up?
No, I mean, you know, this is always based on when somebody comes forward. Lately, it seems to be a lot more often than it had been in the past, but nothing on the horizon. We did have an applicant who was supposed to be here, and then we realized that there was more, it was a little bit more problematic, and they pulled the application. So whether they come back or not, I don't know. We'll see.
Okay, can I get a motion to adjourn?
I'll make the motion. I'll second the motion to adjourn.
That was Richard, and then that was Tony.
Yep.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Excellent.
All right. Have a good night, everyone.
Thanks, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Good job, Dino. That was less than 30 minutes.
I tried.
You crushed it.
I tried. Tony, you know what you get to aim for next time, Tony.
I know. I guess
the bar has been set.
Keep safe, everybody. Thanks.
All right. You too. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
See you, folks.
Bye, Matt.